So, I have the pleasure of introducing today's platform speaker, who is here with us today, live in person. Joshua Tucker is a professor of politics, affiliated professor. I don't know what an affiliated professor is as opposed to a real professor. Maybe he'll explain. Of Russian and Slavic studies, and affiliated professor also of data science at New York University, my alma mater. He is director of NYU's Jordan Center for Advanced Study of Russian, a co-director of the NYU Center for Social Media and Politics, and co-author and editor of the award-winning politics and policy blog at the Washington Post, The Monkey Cage. He is co-chair of the Independent Academic Advisory Team for the 2020 Facebook Election Research Study, and he serves on the advisory board of the American National Election Study, the comparative study of electoral systems, and numerous academic journals. And that's not all. He was co-founder and co-editor of the Journal of Experimental Political Science. His most recent book is the co-edited Social Media and Democracy, The State of the Field by Cambridge University Press. So that's his topic for today, social media and democracy. And welcome to our platform, Joshua.
All right. It is so exciting to be here. I have told everyone about this, that this is my first talk in person since I think it was March 6th at MIT in 2020. I've given a ton of talks on Zoom since then, but I was always wondering when I would be speaking to people in person again. And it's also my first hybrid talk. So welcome to everyone who's out on Zoom. Do you want to throw the first slide up now? Thank you very much for the super kind introduction. It's an amazing pleasure to be here. Let me just start with this stopwatch. It's an amazing pleasure to be here. I'm going to talk to you today about social media and democracy. The first thing I'm going to say and the last thing I'm going to say, though, is that all of the research I'm going to be showing you here today is the result of co-authored work with an incredible number of wonderful scholars. Most of which are affiliated with the Center for Social Media and Politics at NYU. You can find more out about us at csmapnyu.org. If you're interested in our research, you can follow us at @smap_NYU, and you can follow me as well @j_a_Tucker. But everything I'm going to show you here today is about the result of lots of hard work from lots and lots of people. This is lab-based research that's being done in the social sciences now. And I'm happy to talk more about that and the peculiar challenges of that at the end if there's interest. So what I'm gonna talk to you about today is the following. I'm gonna begin by trying to give you a big picture view for thinking about social media and democracy. And then, to thank you all for coming out here today on a Sunday, on a beautiful Sunday, what I would like you to walk away from here with is I'm gonna show you briefly four different findings from four different studies that we've done at the Center for Social Media and Politics that I think are super interesting and may be a surprise to you, may cut against what you think you know about the relationship between social media and politics. And then I'll close, as I started, by telling you just a little bit more about where you can learn more. So next slide, please. All right, so what I want to begin is by thinking about a sort of big picture way of thinking about social media and democracy. And we were speaking before I came in here today, and I was asked, you know, why does it all seem so sinister, social media? Why does it seem like it's destroying everything? And my response was, well, you know, if I had been here 6 years ago, we would have been saying, wow, social media, it's going to save the world, right? It's going to spread democracy around the world because it's something authoritarian regimes can't control. And indeed, famously, Larry Diamond, who's a professor at Stanford University, published this paper in the Journal of Democracy that was called Liberation Technology. They eventually even made it into a book. And this was about how social media was going to spread democracy around the world. But then, by 2017, in the aftermath of the 2016 U.S. presidential elections, my co-author, Nate Persily, publishing in the exact same journal, the Journal of Democracy, published a piece called Can Democracy Survive the Internet? So we were trying to think about how, you know, I like Larry, I like Nate, they're both super smart guys, right? Did one of them get this totally wrong? Like, were we wrong 10 years ago about liberation technology? Or are we wrong today about can democracy survive the internet? So I got together a group of co-authors and we put together a piece where we tried to answer this, right? How can social media be both liberation technology and can democracy survive the internet? And this is the argument that we make, and just in a nice thing, we published the piece. It is called From Liberation to Turmoil, again, in the Journal of Democracy. So it's in there as well. And we try to reconcile these two things. And we add, slide please. We add, our argument is fairly simple. And the argument goes like this. You just need to make two assumptions about social media, that, and with those two assumptions in hand, you can explain how social media can be both liberation technology and can democracy survive the internet. And the first of these assumptions is that social media gives voice to people who don't have access to mainstream media. So social media is a way for people who are excluded from access from mainstream media to have a voice, to be able to communicate. Next slide, please. But at the same time, despite the fact, and this is undeniable, that social media has democratized access to information. It has made more information available to more people than at any time in human history. It is still a tool that can be used for censorship. So if we take these two things together, voice to the voiceless, but at the same time, it's still a tool that can be used to censorship, how does this play out? Slide. So we begin with a new hope, which is social media as liberation technology and the context of authoritarian regimes. Who in authoritarian regimes doesn't have access to mainstream media? Well, it's probably a lot of other potentially would-be authoritarians who might be nasty for other reasons. But it is undoubtedly, almost by definition, pro-democracy forces, people who want to bring about regime change to democratize society, are not going to be given access to state-run television and to the media in authoritarian regimes. So in an authoritarian regime, the advent of social media gives voice to pro-democracy activists. It allows them to spread their message. It allows them to coordinate on strategies. Crucially, it allows them to find each other. One of the big things we've learned about social scientists is that in authoritarian regimes, one of the biggest things that has to do with whether or not people will engage in pro-democracy movements is simply knowing how many other anti-regime pro-democracy supporters are out there, right? So social media can be extremely valuable in these contexts. And in the context of authoritarian regimes, it is something that can help, and we have seen it help, pro-democracy movements. However, this doesn't all happen in a vacuum. And it may be that going back 10 years ago, when social media first burst on the scene, authoritarian leaders who are not particularly, authoritarian regimes are not particularly well set up to get bad news to the authoritarian leader, right? Like your career advancement depends on pleasing the authoritarian leader, coming in and saying, hey, there's this new thing out there that's potentially problematic, maybe not the best way to go. So maybe there was a period of time where these regimes had a blind spot to it. If we think back to the 2011 protests in Russia following the fraudulent Duma elections, if we think about the Arab Spring and what happened in Tahrir Square in Egypt. But of course, these things don't last for long, and you get to the next phase, which we call the Empire Strikes Back, or repression technology, which is that regimes respond, and they respond to the fact that they now have these online threats. And regimes respond in lots of ways, and we've written a lot about this at the Center for Social Media and Politics and happen to talk more. There are lots of different things that regimes have at their disposal. But one of the things that's super interesting about what's happened in the digital information age is that if we think of traditional censorship as restricting access to information, right? We can think in the digital era of like the Great Firewall of China, shutting down the internet, shutting down access to Twitter or to Facebook. But in the digital age, we've also seen another strategy for censorship, which is to control the information environment. My co-author on a piece we wrote on this, Molly Roberts, has referred to this as the strategy of you can have fear, friction, or flooding. Flooding is you try to put information out there. So maybe we're putting out pro-democracy information, but it becomes harder to find that because the internet is overwhelmed with pro-regime information, right? One of the most interesting studies about the Chinese regime is that it's been discovered that they pay bureaucrats to go online every morning and basically just say happy talk, like, I'm so glad to be Chinese today. You know, what a great day to be living in China. Because you want to try to change the discussion. But some of what goes on is of a more, oh, next slide, please. Sorry, there we go. Some of what goes on is of a much more nefarious version. And you get the rise of what you may have heard called bots, these automated accounts or trolls. We'll come back to them a little bit. We're actually going to talk about Russian trolls later on in the talk. But actors who work for the state, who try to take over the social media environment, change the nature of the conversation, make it harder for pro-democracy activists to exist there. And so you get the rise of these bots and trolls and all sorts of sort of nefarious actors online. Okay, next slide, please. All right, so then how does this reverberate into democratic societies? Well, let's put these two things together. One, we said social media gives voice to people who lack voice, who don't have access to mainstream media. So who lacks access to mainstream media in democratic societies? Well, if you want to take a kind of Noam Chomsky Marxist type view of the media being a tool of corporate America, you'll say progressive voices, right? So what do we see with social media? We see Occupy Wall Street. We see Black Lives Matter. So in some ways, this is very helpful for if you have a progressive vision for society. Social media can be useful for progressive voices that may not have access to mainstream media. But mainstream media has also historically in democracies done a very good job of keeping off of the airwaves people who are antithetical to democratic and liberal democratic society. It's getting a little bit harder to say this now with the rise of One America Network and certain parts of Fox News, but you don't generally turn on the TV in democratic societies and see Nazis preaching overthrow of the democratic order. But what does social media do? Social media gives voice to people who don't have access to mainstream media. So in democratic societies, you get the rise of the anti-systemic forces. Social media in democratic societies can make it easier for non-democratic forces to get the same benefits from social media that pro-democratic forces get in autocratic regimes. But meanwhile, you also have these anti-systemic forces are able to sort of harness some of the tools that have been developed in the context of these authoritarian regimes, the bots, the trolls, the ways to amplify your voice online. So you get to 2016 in the US election where you can have small numbers of people. And that's one of the things I'm going to show you as we jump into the next part of the talk, where you can actually have small numbers of people who harbor these kind of extremist views, but they can make themselves seem much more popular by being able to amplify their voices using these tools such as bots and trolls. And it's dangerous too, because you worry about it becoming a self-fulfilling prophecy. This, of course, as well, is why what's been going on with Trump and being kicked off Twitter, banned from Facebook for another 2 years, why these are so kind of consequential in this regard. So the argument we make, and again, I'm just starting to give you a kind of big picture flavor of this, is that social media itself is neither good nor bad for democracy, which is not to say we can't have a very well thought out and reasoned argument about whether particular policies that social media companies adopt are good or bad for democracy. But we argue social media itself is neither good nor bad for democracy. It's actually it's an arena in which powerful political actors can contest for power, the same way powerful political actors contest for power in lots of different arenas. So my answer to you is, and that's why we call it From Liberation to Turmoil, it's both of those things, right? It is liberation technology, and it's also can democracy survive the internet? All right, so that's the big picture. Please advance slide. Sorry, that was the last slide. That was the thing. Okay, so now what I'm going to do for the rest of the thing to reward you for coming out this morning, I'm going to show you briefly about four different research projects that we've done at the Center for Social Media and Politics, and I'm going to hopefully leave you here knowing more about social media than you left, and hopefully upending some thoughts you may have had and showing you the value of rigorous scientific research to understand this phenomenon of the relationship between social media and democracy, which is something that everyone is happy to talk about. Pundits are happy to talk about it. Politicians are happy to talk about it. People go on TV and talk about this all the time, but to really understand what's going on takes a lot of hard work and it takes scientific analysis. So what I'm going to do is hopefully convince you of the virtue of paying attention to the scientific research by showing you and helping you answer these questions. So we're going to start by talking about fake news, and I'll talk to you about who has shared fake news. Then I'm going to talk about social media and polarization, about whether Facebook usage makes people more politically polarized. Then I'm going to talk about hate speech online, whether hate speech on Twitter increased over the course of the 2016 elections. And finally, I'm going to talk about bots and trolls. So I said I would come back to those at end, and I'm going to show you some under review research right now about what was the impact of exposure to Russian trolls on Twitter during the 2016 election. All right, so the first thing I'm going to show you, we're going to talk about, is who shared fake news in 2016 on Facebook. So in the 2016 election, it's hard to believe this, but like 5 years ago, people were not really talking about fake news in this country. And in the aftermath of the 2016 election, this suddenly, in the late part of the election and in the early aftermath, this burst into the popular vernacular. This became a huge question. Everyone became aware of what was going on. With the advent of these of websites that purported to try to be newspapers. They looked like they were news websites, but they actually were just publishing fake stories. But there was a big question of this, which was, who were the people who online was actually sharing these stories? Who was posting links to these stories on their Facebook pages? Next slide, please. So we realized in the aftermath of the 2016 election that we actually had in our possession the data to answer this. Now, we had a survey in the field in the 2016 US elections where we talked to people three times over the course of the election period. And I'll come back to that survey at the end as well in the last one when I talk about these Russian bots. For this one, what's just important is that we had surveyed people, but we had also asked them if they would be willing to share their Facebook data with us as part of the election. Now, this was before the Cambridge Analytica scandal had broken, so it was still fairly easy at that point. We got permission to do this. We, of course, got permission from the users, the people participating in their study, in our study, but about half the people in the study agreed to share their Facebook data with us. And so we knew what they had shared on, we knew what they had posted on their Facebook page over the course of the campaign, which allowed us, given the fact that we had also surveyed them, we knew their demographic profile, we could look at who was actually sharing links to these fake news sources on Facebook. Next slide, please. So the first thing we learned, sorry if this is hard to read, but what you see here is, if you look over here, what you see is, this is the number of links shared to these fake news websites. And on the y-axis here, you have the number of people who shared those links. And what you see, and it's hard to see this because it's really dark, but this is something you see a lot with political behavior, and particularly with online political behavior, and particularly with this kind of malevolent online political behavior. And this is what's known as a power law, a power law, whereby you have these curves where lots and lots of people have no engagement with the behavior. And I'm going to show you this again later on when we get to the Russian trolls. And then small numbers of people have a lot of behavior with this. So the first piece of news that comes out of this study is actually fairly good news. And it's that most people in our sample, in fact, over 90% of the people in our sample, or close to 90% of the people in our sample, didn't share a single link to one of these fake news websites. Next slide, please. All right, well, who did share links to these websites? Well, the first thing we learned is that it was not liberals or moderates. The people who were sharing links to these websites were people who were self-declared conservatives and people who were either conservative or very conservative. Now, of course, that's consistent with two possible worlds. One, it could be that people who are conservative are more likely to share false information online, or it could be the fact that there was more information online that was false that was amenable to conservatives. And we know from lots of other research that in the 2016 election, the vast, vast majority of false news that was put out had a pro-Trump slant. There was much less pro-Clinton false news floating around in the ecosystem. So I think this is a very good confirmation of our method. This is a factually accurate as to what was happening. The vast majority of false news was being shared let's put it this way. Conservatives were much more likely to share false news than liberals and moderates, but I want to be very careful. This type of research design does not allow us to in any way, shape, or form to adjudicate whether, given the opportunities, liberals wouldn't be just as likely. And in fact, in the supplementary appendix of this study, when we broke this down by articles, where we did look at a few articles that were pro-Clinton, in this fake news category, those pro-Clinton fake news stories were more likely to be shared by liberals, much as we would expect. But, and here's the kicker in the next slide, what we did find that was robust to controlling for ideology, to controlling for partisanship, and this is the most publicized finding that's ever come out of my lab in the history of all the work we've done over the last 10 years, but we found that people over 65 on average, we're sharing 7 times as many links to these fake news websites as the millennials were. And we also found what's known as a monotonic relationship. The older you got, the more likely you were to, on average, share these links to news sites. And this was very important because I think the original narrative after the election was about Gen Z, you know, the kids messing everything up because they're newfangled toys and they're on social media. And it seemed like the first set of policy responses to this was really aimed at like high school digital literacy classes, which don't get me wrong, I'm a huge fan of high school digital literacy classes. But I think we want to, I think what we learned from this is that high school digital literacy classes wasn't going to actually solve the problem. What is even super interesting about this is that in subsequent research and ongoing projects in the lab, we've been doing a ton of work on people's ability to identify the veracity of news in real time. And of course, the first explanation when you start showing people this figure that they come up with is digital literacy. Right, and the idea is, well, why is this happening? Well, it's because people like me go and call their parents, and my mom is on the line, so hi, mom. I'm not sure how much she likes this. So go and call their parents, and they say, hey, get on Facebook so you can see pictures of your grandchildren. And then people who are less familiar with Facebook get on Facebook, and they see a picture, a headline, and a blurb, and it says New York Times. And then they also see a picture and a headline and a blurb, and it says the Denver Guardian. And the Denver Guardian story is about the Post and the Pope endorsing Donald Trump. But of course, the Denver Guardian doesn't exist. It's not actually a newspaper, and the New York Times does. So this was the first thing everyone thought about when we presented this research, that it was digital literacy. It was a generation less familiar with the vagaries of the internet. But what turns out, actually, in the research we've been doing lately, is that people of all ages are about equal at identifying correctly the veracity of news. So there's something else going on here. It's not that people who are older are having a more difficulty figuring out what's false and what's true, but that coincides with a world, and we've replicated this now on a much, much bigger data set. So this is a very stable finding. There's something going on where people who are older are both simultaneously just as good as everybody else at identifying whether news is true and are still sharing it much more often than people of other ages. So that's a puzzle, and that's one of the things we're working on going forward. All right, I'm gonna skip ahead. Could you go ahead 4 slides? I just think we're running a little late on time. And I'm going to jump to hate speech on Twitter in 2016. So if you were paying attention to the election in 2016, which I'm sure most of us in this room were and on this Zoom call, and you were watching news stories about it, you would have seen a lot of articles about this, about hate speech accelerating on Twitter over the course of the US of hate speech accelerating online. I mean, after all, Donald Trump was someone who announced his candidacy by walking down the stairs, not far from here. I know I passed the hotel on the way out of the subway getting here, but I think it was over at Trump Towers, by announcing his candidacy by calling Mexicans rapists and murderers, right? And so there was a lot of information in the media about the rise of hate speech over the course of the campaign. And you would see lots and lots of headlines like this. And in particular, we see the one at the bottom, massive rise in hate speech on Twitter during the presidential election. So we set out, next slide, please. We set out to try to answer the following question and to see if we could find evidence showing this was the case. And so the question in particular we wanted to answer was, to what extent did online hate speech and white nationalist rhetoric on Twitter increase over the course of Trump's 2016 campaign and in the aftermath of his election? And so the question we began with was, okay, if all these claims that all are being made by all these journalists are correct, what should that look like? So next slide, please. Oh, let me tell you first. I'm first going to tell you. So the data that we used for this, in order to answer this, the results that I'm going to show you here, they are based on a sample of over 1.2 billion, that's billion with a B, tweets that we collected during the campaign and in the aftermath. And the tweets are broken down into two categories. One, which we call political Twitter, which was 150 million tweets referencing Hillary Clinton and 600 million tweets referencing Donald Trump. The disparity between those two is an interesting story unto itself, although of course he wins the election and becomes president, so that's part of what's this disparity, but it was there long before that. And then, because as we started going down this thing that we became increasingly surprised by our results, and we thought maybe we're missing something, we also included a random sample of 500,000 American Twitter users. So this was, we actually used a random number generator to generate random tweet IDs. We looked to see if the person existed, to see if they were in the US. So we also have another 400 million tweets sent by approximately 500,000 US Twitter users. Next slide, please. We used two different methods. I'm happy to talk more about them during the question and answer if there's interest, but one is based on what's kind of known as a dictionary method. We took lots of different words that are associated with hateful speech, and we looked to find tweets that had them, but then we used machine learning to screen out what are known as false positive, because lots of words that show up in hateful tweet dictionaries are not actually used as hateful speech. For example, calling someone a taco can be a derogatory term for a Latino or a Latina person in the United States. But of course, most of the time people use the word taco on Twitter, they're using it to talk about food. So it's things like that. And there are other things. People also often criticize hate speech in tweets by repeating it. And so we don't want to code those as hate speech. We also then, again, as we became increasingly sort of surprised by the findings we were getting, we thought maybe because we were using dictionaries developed from hate speech offline, we were missing the way people actually talked about hate speech online. So we developed some entirely new methods to try to measure sort of the semantic similarity between speech in places online that we knew were racist and that we knew where people were using hateful language. And then we went back and looked at the sort of semantic similarity over time between the speech on Twitter and these known repositories of online hateful speech. Anyway, so that's just to say we did this lots of different ways to try to figure this out. All right, next slide, please. All right, so we started thinking, what would hate speech online, if everyone was right about hate speech increasing over time, what would it look like? So we drew this graph here, which simple graph where we have time on the x-axis, we have the prevalence of hate speech, if we're able to measure that, and then we have election day here. And so if hate speech was increasing over the course of Trump's campaign, we might expect something that looks like this. Next slide. We might expect something that looks like this. A general kind of increase. Obviously, it wouldn't be quite this neat and it wouldn't be this thing, but a general linear increase. And you could imagine this. Trump first declares, he kind of seems like he's a joke, but then he starts doing better. It starts to reassure people like, oh, maybe we can talk like this. And then as time goes on and the more successful it becomes, it kind of builds and feeds on itself. Or alternatively, next slide, maybe it's something that looks like this. Like over the course of the campaign, he's got his supporters, it kind of stays at its little level, nobody really thinks this is serious, but then he wins the election unexpectedly, and all of a sudden, if you all remember the sort of ethos in November of 2016, I can't believe I've woken up in a different world, and this kind of thing. So maybe things really did change when he won. So this would also be a sort of, maybe it took him actually winning to unleash the hate that everybody was talking about online. So it might look something like this. All right, next slide, please. So here's our data. This is 1.2 billion tweets on one slide. So I don't know if you've ever seen 1.2 billion anything on one slide. But what I can show you here is that these are the tweets that we identified as being hateful. This is the monthly proportion of tweets that were hateful in our collection. So our collection of tweets mentioning Trump, mentioning Clinton, or our random sample. And what you see here is neither of those lines. You don't see anything that looks like something going up linearly over time, and you don't see anything where there was a shift and then it became markedly higher. Interestingly enough, the two red lines here that do look particularly high, This has to do with the Muslim travel ban, and that was the first time Hillary Clinton weighed in after the election about anything Trump was doing, as well as the deputy attorney general who resigned because not wanting to enforce this policy, also a woman, and it unleashed a torrent of misogynistic tweets. And that is what that little spike that goes on there. So this is all of our data. If you look at this next slide, which you can zoom in, which you will not be able to read anything, and I'm aware of it. Maybe somebody on Zoom with a big monitor can read it. But what this is, and what was one of the low moments, I think, of my academic career, was coming up with deciding to write this kind of slide. But this is 9 different types of hateful speech. We have anti-Asian hate speech. We have anti-gay and lesbian hate speech. We have anti-Semitic speech, et cetera, with white nationalist speech in the right-hand corner. What I want you to see from this, though, to take away from this, is that in no case, even when we disaggregate it by all these different types of speech, do we see anything like those original 2 lines, where it was just going up over time. Instead, what we see is something that actually has a mathematical term, which is called burstiness. So next slide, please. We're going to zoom in on anti-Islamic hate speech, anti-Muslim hate speech. And in this particular case, what you can see is, and this is what we basically get across all of these graphs, we get these spikes in hate speech. But then it re-equilibrates back down to whatever the underlying baseline is. And we can figure out why some of these spikes exist. So for example, the second spike, the long, large spike on the left side there, for those room, this is after the Bataclan nightclub shooting in Paris. And this is a well-known phenomenon that after Islamic extremist terrorist attacks, you often see spikes in online hate speech. So this is the story that we get. So next slide. So our results are, contrary to the received wisdom, our analysis does not show a systematic increase in hate speech over the course of the campaign or after the election. Similarly, there are no significant increases in white nationalist rhetoric over the course of the campaign or in any of these data sets. What we do see instead is that hate speech, and this was only through June of 2017, is bursty, but doesn't seem to be significantly increasing or decreasing. Now, I want to be very clear. The findings that we've found here, these can be consistent with a world in which hate speech online is a terrible problem. I've said nothing normative in any of this. I didn't use the word good or bad. I showed you levels. You may think those levels are innocuous. You might think those levels are horrible. But it's also consistent with a world where, when we see these power laws, that there are small numbers of people that embed themselves in very hateful communities, not even in places like Twitter, but on more specialized platforms like Gab, and then decide to go into a synagogue and shoot people in Pittsburgh. So it is not to say that the story that I'm showing you here is not that this is better or worse than you think it is, or not to say this is not a problem. But it is to point to the importance of not just going with what everyone is telling us to try to understand what's really going on. And I think in particular, why this is, I wish that we had had this research, 4 years ago, is that I think all this talk of hate speech increasing can be self-fulfilling because it can normalize it. It can make young people think, oh, it's okay to talk like this online. When in reality, that's not what was happening, at least as best we could tell, is that it was not systematically increasing, which probably meant it wasn't spreading. And when you woke up the day after the 2016 election, it wasn't like suddenly a lot more people became racist and decided they were going to express it online. It probably means we were wrong, living here in New York City, in estimating how many people really were racist out there. And we do have lots of speech before the election. And I'm sure if we had the data, you'd go back and find that, we would find that going earlier. That's the takeaway here. So I want to be careful about calving that. All right, I'm already at a half an hour, so I'm going to just quickly show you one more thing. It's super interesting. Can we go to the next slide? So the final thing I've been promising you, I would talk about trolls. So this is some hot off the press research from the Center for Social Media and Politics. And as many of you heard, one of the big stories about 2016, I'm sure you've heard of this, the Mueller probe, right? Russia tried to interfere in the US elections. And Russia tried to interfere in the US elections in a number of different ways. What I'm not going to talk about here was Russia's interfering in the election by hacking the DNC and releasing Podesta's emails. Kathleen Hall Jamieson has wrote a wonderful book about this for people who are interested in that. What I am going to talk about is the other way that got a lot of press about Russia interfering in the election, which was Russia's activity on Twitter. And to date, the research community has learned quite a lot. Twitter, to their credit, released the collection of all of the Russian of the tweets by all of the Russian trolls that they had identified. And that's allowed researchers to dig into this. They sort of had to be forced to do this because they testified before Congress and all sorts of things like that. But I want to give them credit for having released this. And we can talk more about in Q&A about the importance of making this data available to researchers. Because if Twitter hadn't released this data publicly, nothing I'm going to tell you now would be known in the public. I would not be able to tell you about it. We wouldn't even know it. But they did in this particular case. And so we learned a lot about them. We learned who was doing this foreign interference. It was largely something called the Internet Research Agency in Russia. That was flooding U.S. election with these troll accounts. We learned a lot about what they did with social media campaigns. We learned a lot about their strategy. We actually published put out a couple pieces in our lab about this that I could spend a long time telling you about. But we know a lot about the strategy of these trolls. But what we didn't know, and we knew who was exposed to them, but what we hadn't learned and haven't learned until now is about the impact of exposure to these trolls. Next slide, please. And that's what I'm going to show you here. Because again, as I mentioned in the Who Shared Fake News on Facebook, the other thing we did in this panel that we had in the field in the 2016 elections was we asked people for their Twitter handles. So I mentioned we surveyed them three times in April of 2016, October of 2016, and after they voted after the election. And of the people in our survey, for about 1,500 of them, we had their Twitter handles. So we used their Twitter handles to see who they followed. And then we collected every tweet from every person that everyone in our sample followed. So this is another, turns out to be another 1.2 billion tweets. But in this collection, we then know every one of these people, if they followed one of these Russian trolls, but more importantly, we know if anyone they followed retweeted something that was posted by those Russian trolls. So what we essentially know for our sample is we know every tweet they could have seen over the course of that election campaign. And we also know what they thought in April of 2016, and we know what they thought at the end of the election campaign, which means that we can measure both exposure and whether there's any relationship between exposure and changes in people's attitudes or preferred vote choice. So the first thing I want to show you, next slide please, is about exposure. So if you look at the top of the figure here, and it is hard, I apologize, person in our sample saw from Russian trolls over the course of the election campaign. And actually, as you look at it, as you get closer to the campaign, it starts to hit 5. On election day, it hits as high as 14. Well, that sounds like a big, That sounds like a big number, right? People are on average seeing 10 tweets, or on election day saw 14 tweets from these Russian trolls. But again, hopefully now you're beginning to think, all right, let's think power law. Let's think is this actually everybody seeing 14 tweets each? No, because if you look at the panel on the left here, and it's hard to see this is a logarithmic scale on the bottom here. And on the y-axis, this is the percentage of people. This is the percentage of the tweets by the Russian trolls that we're seeing on the x-axis by the percentage of people. And what we see is it says 1% here. 1% of our sample saw 75% of the tweets from the Russian trolls. So we had 1,500 people, right? That means 1% of our sample, 15 of those people, accounted for the exposure to 75% of these tweets. We get to 10% of our sample, that's 150 people, they account for 99.9% of the exposure. So the first thing I want you to take away is that exposure to these tweets were incredibly concentrated. And as I said a second ago, as we see from the top, like 5 tweets a day, that sounds like a lot. But if any of you are big Twitter people and you scroll through your Twitter feed, you probably scroll through 5 tweets in about half a second, right? And so we started thinking, well, where, if we think that these tweets from these trolls were changing behavior or changing attitudes, let's compare them to other, like how much did they, what are some other sources people had to learn stuff about the election? So we looked at how many tweets did they see from politicians? How many tweets did they see from media sources? Next slide, please. And what you can see on this next slide is that when we compare Russian trolls to politicians or to media sources, what we end up with is that it's absolutely dwarfed by these other sources. So yes, people were exposed to tweets from these Russian trolls, but they had 4 times as many tweets that they saw from politicians. They had 30 times as many tweets that they saw from media sources. So what they saw from these Russian trolls was a drop in the bucket, And we know that most people didn't see any tweets from these trolls at all. So you can see where this is going, right? Did these tweets really change people's attitudes about things? Did they change their vote choice? I'm going to show you one more piece of the puzzle, which is, if you can advance to the next slide, is that we also can now tell you about who was exposed to these tweets by these Russian trolls. And what we see is overwhelmingly Republicans, i.e. the same people who were predisposed to vote for Donald Trump in the first place. And it actually turns out to be not only just Republicans, strong Republicans, but also men. All right, so now we have all these pieces. High levels of concentration of exposure, dwarfed by, for most people aren't seeing anything. Those who are seeing things are male Republicans, Trump's base of support, right? And we also know that for everybody, it's being dwarfed by the amount of information they're seeing from everything. So now we can ask the question we really care about. Next slide, please. Does it have any effect on polarization? I'm not gonna go into detail on this, but the basic thing is, we can go back and show this chart if you want. The answer is no. These are four different ways of looking at polarization, two different ways of looking at polarization combined with looking at two different ways of looking at exposure to the trolls. These are estimates of changes. We see nothing. And then finally, the kicker on the next slide, when we look at the impact on vote choice, we see no effect. These dots are our best guess at estimates. Moving to the right would be making you more likely to vote for Trump. Moving to the left would be making you more likely to vote for Clinton. These colored parts, the light parts here, these are our error bars. Everything is around zero. So we have absolutely no confidence that there was any impact on people changing their likelihood. Now, if I looked at the relationship between being exposed to trolls and voting for Trump, it of course would be high, because that's exactly who was exposed to these tweets. But if I look at, did they have any change in people's predispositions, it makes none. All right, so next slide. What do we know now? We know there was non-trivial exposure, which is interesting, but it was heavily concentrated and among those most likely to support Trump. We know there was orders of magnitude more exposure to media and politicians, and not surprisingly, we found no systematic effect, or maybe it is surprising, but not surprising, hopefully after I walked you through all these other things, effect on issue polarization or effect on vote choice. Now, why is this important? This is important because we spent a long time thinking that the Russians were able to reach in and through their deviousness change the outcomes of our elections. And what makes me really nervous right now is that I spent a lot, my first thought was, this was one of the worst influence operations in the history of Putin. This was one of his colossal mistakes, because if he had just stayed out of it, Trump would have won the election without his meddling, and Trump was going to take the sanctions off of Russia. The sanctions instead, because he gets caught with his hand in the cookie jar, the sanctions get exacerbated. There's only like one thing that you get votes of 99-1 and 100-0 in the US Senate under Trump, and that's to expand sanctions on Russia. That this was perhaps the worst influence operation you could imagine. Terrible mistake on the part of the Russians to do this, because they didn't make any difference in this regard, and they caused all these problems for themselves down the road by poisoning the well for what would have been the most pro-Russia president we had had in the post-Cold War era. But what worries me now is that even if I think the direct implications of this influence operation were a failure, I worry about the indirect influence. Because we have spent 4 years with lots of people thinking in this country that our election results are so fragile that Russia could hire 30, 20-somethings and change the outcome of the election just by putting some tweets on Twitter and some posts on Facebook. And where are we now in this country? We're now at a crisis point where we have something like 60 to 70% of Republicans who don't believe the most recent election was legitimately conducted. Are those two things connected? Did we somehow sow the seeds for getting people to understand that election results are fragile and can easily be upset by nefarious actors? Now, I know the big lie is completely different, but at the highest level, nefarious actors can do something online and change things. That's what the story was about the influence of these tweets. And we have shown now that we think the influence of these things were nothing. I wish we had been able, this had been the received wisdom and we had been able to show this 4 years ago, maybe fewer people would be susceptible to the big lie if we hadn't spent all this time thinking that this could have an effect too. As you go forward, I would argue that this is the importance where I started the talk of doing this kind of rigorous hard scientific research. I started my career studying mass political behavior in post-communist countries. I wrote my first book about economic voting in Eastern Europe. I never turned on the TV and saw pundits debating economic voting in Eastern Europe and was not sitting there in my room thinking, oh, they don't have the story right. But this is totally different for me, and I think this is much more consequential. And I hope that every time I give one of these talks, I can convince people of the importance of doing this kind of rigorous scientific research, because if we don't do the research, pundits are gonna fill it with things based on anecdote and first observation, and it's amazing how difficult it is to dislodge those kind of general beliefs once they become set in the public, and not just in the public, but in policymakers. So next slide, please. So if you're interested and wanna know more, and in particular wanna see me talk for 30 pages about the importance of data access for researchers and the importance of making sure researchers can do this kind of scientific research, this is the book with Nate Persily. It's Social Media and Democracy. You can order it on Amazon. It's available open access. So if you want the PDF of it, you can get it for free just by downloading it off Cambridge University Press. Although it's a great book to buy, it looks good on your coffee table. But if you want to read more about data access, that's exactly what we wrote about in the conclusion here about the importance of doing this kind of research. But it's a fantastic book with a whole bunch of chapters that are sort of summarizing lots more of the kind of stuff I've showed you today from lots of different studies. We got incredibly good authors to write about these different topics. Nate's a law professor, so we also combined it with four chapters at the end from policymakers about different things that you can do if you're interested. If you've heard about Section 230 and these kind of things, we have chapters in there on that as well. So you can download it for free, or you can purchase the book if you're interested. Next slide, and I just want to conclude by thanking all of you for your time today. I apologize for going a little bit over. Thanks for joining me on a Sunday morning. Everything I've shown you here today was the result of collaborative research from all of these people who you've seen contributed to things that you did today. So thanks so much, very much for your time.
We do have some time for questions, if there are some. So why don't you just add?
Yes. So for those of you in the room, if you have a question, those of you in the room, please wait to ask your question until you have the microphone, so everyone on Zoom can hear. And those of you on Zoom, if you have a question, please type it in the chat, and we can read it out.
That was very well done.
So you talk about, you mentioned that every time you give this talk, you hope that people are paying attention to the need for doing this science, this whatever we are here. Have the Tucker Carlson's or the Chris Hayes's of the world invited you on their show so you can get the message out there?
Not yet, but we're working on it. So if you know their bookers, tell them about us. We actually, and our donors who support the research, our funders, one of the things we have a communications director now, and we're really trying hard to figure out how to do a better job of this. But yeah, that is something that we need to do. Oddly, I seem to be asked to go on TV in Asia a fair amount to talk about some of the work we've been doing. So I've been on CNBC Asia twice, but no, that's exactly what we're trying to figure out. We're trying to figure out how to break through in this regard. And it is a particularly crucial moment as well, because I think we are at a time where regulation of the platforms is being talked about and considered. It is a Congress that's more amenable to this now. We'll see what happens. Obviously, there's a lot of things on the agenda now. But it is super, super important, we think, that the data, that the kind of data we used here to do this research. One of the things you'll get if you download the book or you buy the book is you'll learn a ton of interesting stuff, but every one of those chapters ends with, and here are 17 important questions we don't know the answer to because we don't have access to the data. And there are a lot of competing, as we think about regulating social media platforms, there are a lot of competing interests at stake. There's privacy, which is super important. There is economic power, which is super important. But there's also the public's right to know what is happening with these platforms. And that's where the academic research community comes in, because we are the only ones who are, maybe investigative journalists too, but our incentives are to make things public. I mean, you hear academia derided as publish or perish, but in this way, it actually aligns the needs of society with what academic job, you know, incentives are. We only get credit for what we do when we tell you about it, right? And none of other actors are like that, right? The politicians have reasons to want to use these things. Economic actors have reasons to want to use these things. So it's crucial that we make sure, because we, the policy decisions that need to be made, they need to be informed by the underlying scientific realities of what's actually happening. If we don't know what's actually happening, we're going to make bad policy decisions, right? And society as a whole. So in that 13th chapter of the book, we have a lot of proposals here. Like, one of the more sort of radical proposals in there is to begin to think about a data tax. And by a data tax, I don't mean the way everyone's normally using it, right? We accept that the state can take some of companies' profits, some of their money, to compensate the state and society for the things the state is providing to those companies so that they can make money, like a court system, like roads, like a defense system so that the country's not invaded, right? There's a lot of things that companies get from working within the confines of a country that's provided them by society. Maybe we need to start thinking about data in that regard too, right? These platforms have made billions and billions and billions of dollars. They've become some of the most powerful and richest companies in the world because we have given them our data, right? Facebook is worth nothing without the data that we provide to Facebook. And so maybe we need to begin to think about that not just Facebook needs to give the state money, but Facebook has a responsibility to provide, make some of that data available for research. Now, I'm talking about things I think here that are crucially important about the future of democracy and democratic society, but there are a million things that can be done with these data that are all sorts of, like emergency disaster response, dealing with LGBT youth and coming out as kids. I mean, there's a million, you can learn about depression. You can learn about so many things from these data. It is such an incredibly valuable tool for scientific research. So we may need to think a little bit about this. But again, remember the competing interests, and this goes back to your question of like why it's important that we get this message out there. Because, you know, breaking up the platform, so breaking up Facebook into Facebook, Instagram, and WhatsApp, which is one of the big things being pushed as a kind of antitrust solution, that will do nothing to help with making sure that there's access to these data for research, right? The needs of privacy often are often antithetical in some ways to the needs for research. And that's another thing we talk about in that last chapter of the book, is reconceptualizing this as not thinking of the privacy debate as simply a good or a bad, because we all want more privacy, right? We all know that it's good, but to begin to think of this as trade-offs between the good of having public information about the impact of these platforms on society and using these platforms to advance scientific understanding versus the needs of privacy and how we deal with those trade-offs, right? Because if the best thing for privacy is shove all the data back into the platforms, but then these data sets are only used for maximizing the profits of these companies, right? Instead of understanding their impact on society.
So. I'm going to take one of the online questions here. From Dan Julin. So these types of tweets seem to not fundamentally change people's political leaning, but can we measure if they make them more likely to actually go out and vote and participate for the candidate that they preferred all along?
Yeah, so this is one of the things we're sort of interested in, we're interested in studying here. Obviously, campaigns are spending a tremendous amount of money on advertising, and I'm not an expert on political advertising, but this has been one of the great debates in political science, is what is the impact of political advertising? We know campaigns spend tons and tons of money on this. There's a school of thought that says, for the most part, they basically cancel each other out, right? We know that most of people's voting behavior can be predicted by other factors other than exposure to this. I'm not in a position where I can talk about, I certainly can't talk about the overall effect of social media. I certainly do believe that Trump was probably helped in 2016 by his social media presence, by what he did on social media. I think his presidency was undeniably impacted by his ability to use Twitter to set the media narrative. And you sort of just look at the dramatic difference in society since Trump was kicked off of Twitter and Facebook. So I don't want to go any farther in saying anything in those particular cases. I will say, in the very specific thing that we studied here of the Russian trolls, it was late in the talk, I was going through this quickly. One of the things we included in that was whether someone who was likely to support Clinton as a function of seeing these tweets was more likely to not vote or which is one of the stories that was spun about how these affected, or was more likely to vote for one of the third party candidates. And that was one of the three tests we had on that slide, and we found no evidence for that as well. So in the case of the Russian trolls, now, what I cannot tell you, and I want to be very clear about this, I had 1,500 people across the country. This is, to the best of my knowledge, the only data set like this that links up people's vote preferences with Twitter data. So it's the best shot we have at the moment. What I can't tell you is whether it made a difference, for example, like we don't have enough oversampling over, for example, African Americans living outside of Milwaukee, right? And we know Wisconsin was super close in that particular election. So I can't tell you if among specifically targeted groups in specific areas of the country. In order to do that, we need much, much bigger studies, which actually need much, much more funding to be able to do. Now, the good news is there is a study in progress about this for Facebook's impact on the 2020 elections. And so eventually we will have more knowledge of this in that regard, but it requires a much larger scale than we had in our particular study.
Thank you. I'm just wondering, I'm not on Twitter, and during his presidency, the intersection of the regular mainstream media repeating the tweets, they were appearing regularly on television with responses in both ways,
right.
But there's a lot of intersectionality. I mean, these things travel, right? And they end up on Facebook, and they end up in people's emails, and they end up on television. So in fact, they're reaching a much wider audience. So maybe the next research needs to be what the interface is between mainstream media and social media.
Yes, absolutely. And this is one of, so I directed a report for the Hewlett Foundation a couple of years ago, which was a sort of precursor to what became the first eight chapters of that book. And this was exactly what we called for, right? That the vast majority of social media, until a couple of years ago, I could have come in here today and given a talk only about YouTube research that we're doing at my lab, and I've shown you stuff, I could have given a talk only about Facebook research. But until like a couple, few years ago, there's no way you would have invited anyone to come in and talk and give a talk about social media that wasn't mainly focused on Twitter. And now, there are good reasons to focus on Twitter, right? It is enormously, it is the politics social media. It is where all the journalists are, all the politicians are. 20% of the country uses Twitter. It's not an inconsequential platform. But 78% of the, 80% of the country uses YouTube and uses Facebook, right? Why was all the research going on Twitter? Because Twitter made the data available. And that's where we get to knowledge being driven by these overarching concerns, right? Tweets are mainly public. It's kind of the way the platform evolved. There are a few people who make their tweets private, but for the vast majority of people, it's public, which means there's not a privacy concern. I can go, you found me on Twitter, right? You went and saw my tweets. Like, we can do this. Nothing I showed you here, and I want to be very clear about this, when the 1.2 billion tweets and the two different studies, the looking at the people, nothing involved anything that was private. All of that was public data that existed in the public square. Lots of Facebook data is private data. People's YouTube viewing histories is not unclear. You know, some things are public, some things are not public. So we called in the Hewlett report for more research, not just on the fact of that getting away from just being in Twitter, but also, you know, we want to do Facebook, we want to do YouTube, TikTok. We need to be looking at TikTok now. This is super important, right? Like, but also the fact of the matter is that people live on multiple platforms. And exactly as you said, looking at the intersection across these different platforms and what's going on, I'm happy to report we have some newer papers where we've been doing that, where we've been using YouTube links and looking at how they appear on Reddit or how they appear on Twitter. We look at changes, and we have a brand new paper that was just published where we look at changes in YouTube's policy that led to a depression of conspiracy-related videos on YouTube, but led to it seemed to have an increasing effect on YouTube-related conspiracy videos showing up on other places where this happened. So, you know, we know people live in this. We've been looking now, I could have come in here to you and talked to you only about, it's one of the chapters in the book, about echo chambers. That's another thing where what you think you know is probably wrong. But echo chambers, one of the things that we've done recently in the lab is begin to start combining people's Twitter and Facebook experiences with what they report they actually watch on television. And it turns out that like a lot of the sort of right-wing echo chamber on Twitter, those same exact people are saying they're watching the CBS News and the NBC News and the ABC News, right? So you're absolutely correct. And again, it's really hard to do this research, both because just the scale and the enormity of it, but also because the restrictions placed on it by platforms. And it, just to swing back again to the importance of it, at the end of the day, I think we're gonna have to adjust the legal environment if we as a society think it's important that we as a society know what's going on. And I've told this to I told this when I testified before Congress, the Congress people, like, this should be a really important thing because these companies are huge, right? And the legal structure is complicated and they don't want to get, I mean, Facebook got a $5 billion fine last time, right? And so they're worried about that being replicated. So we have to think about adjusting the legal environment to prioritize allowing this type of research to take place, but to make sure it takes place in a way that's safe, that's ethical, and that protects your data from what happened with Cambridge Analytica as well. Okay, so thanks so much.